want to give our boys and girls an opportunity to go to Kid Life. So if you guys will head that direction to my left, your leaders will meet you there. A lot of exciting things going on this weekend. I know several from our music ministry were in the Metroplex at the Linger Conference, and I got to thinking, now, you can't put this kind of stuff together, guys. When I look at the topic of the sermon this morning and then the title of the conference they were going to, and you probably noticed some of the t-shirts, Let Us Linger, just think about that as we go through this sermon, how God kind of put multiple things together. I told you last week I had hit a roadblock in sermon planning, and I just could not write about the ninth chapter of Zechariah. And it's not that I didn't understand it, it just wasn't coming. And while Josh and I were at the conference this last couple of weeks ago, I just knew what it was supposed to be. There was another sermon that needed to go in there before we got to the chapter 9. And so we've covered some territory with a kind of a mini-series, and it was dealing with the fact that God wants to transform our lives, and He wants to change. You remember there were multiple things from religion to relationship, and there was five of them. I don't remember immediately what they all were, but there was that transformation that comes from the inside out that God wants to do. And it was real tempting just to go ahead and go with the next sermon. Then I realized there's something that's got to take place. For that to take place, something else has to take place. There has to be something that is the first thing. And that's what we're going to look at today. And we're going to back up into the book of Exodus. We'll be discussing and looking at an event that most of us is fairly familiar to us at one point or another as we've done our Bible study. And God is talking specifically in our text today to Moses, which would be the representation of leadership. But I want you to see that when we move to the New Testament time, which we live in, because of the cross event, because of the fact that when Jesus died on the cross, that curtain that was between the Holy of Holies and the most holy place, that curtain split, and it split from the top to the bottom. And the significance of that is that we all, as believers, have direct access to God. Whether we take advantage of it or not, we have direct access to God. So I believe the principles that we see here in Exodus 24 in particular apply today to all of us. And so as we look at what took place in Moses' life, let me encourage you to say, I need to hear what Moses heard. I need to be obedient like Moses was obedient. So would you pray with me before we begin? Lord God, we thank you that we can gather in this place and that we can worship you. I thank you for the fact that we've already been worshiping you this morning. Lord, now we want to hear a word from you. We want to hear what you say to your people. So would you speak to us? We know your Holy Spirit is in this place. Lord, we welcome you here. As we sang a while ago, we don't have to ask you to come because you indwell us, so you're here. But now, Lord, we want to see your manifest presence in our midst. So, Lord, make yourself known. May we be listening. May we be open to what you have to say. And then may we be obedient to your command. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. First thing I want us to see in Exodus chapter 24, let's look at verses 1 through 2. Exodus 24, verses 1 through 2. And if you're using your Bibles, that is great. I encourage you to do that. We're going to have the scripture on the screen. But folks, nothing replaces this, okay? If you're doing it on your phones and so forth, that's great too. But open God's Word as we do this. And we're gonna cover a lot of scripture this morning. Verse 1 of chapter 24, then he said to Moses, of course he being God, go up to the Lord, you and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of Israel's elders, and bow in worship at a distance. Moses alone is to approach the Lord, but the others are not to approach, and the people are not to go up with him. There's several points here in these two verses. First of all, I want you to see that this is not at the thinking of or the starting of Moses. God is making the invitation. God is initiating this event. Moses was leading. Moses was doing what he was supposed to be doing, but God said, it's now time, Moses, for you to come up to the Lord. When we get an invitation, listen, there's nothing in us that would cause us to say, I want to be in God's presence. Matter of fact, that's a pretty frightening place to be for a people that are sinful. But God responds to us, and he says, go up to the Lord. He said that to Moses as a leader here. He says it to us today on this side of the cross as Christians. Listen, what we need to understand is that on this side of the cross, for all Christians, you caught that Greek word there, right? All? It means the same thing. It means it's all of us, not just certain ones of us, not just for the leaders. Today we're going to have a leader meeting. This is not just for leaders. This is for all of God's people. It's an invitation, and this invitation is intrinsically intertwined with our call to salvation. When God calls us to salvation, he is also calling us to an intimate relationship with him. So often we look at God as the man upstairs, or we see him as that person that is so removed, and God is different, and the Christian faith is different from any other because we have a God that wants us to have a close, intimate relationship with him. And it's more than coming to church on Sunday morning. It's more than serving. It's more than doing things for God. It is about being in the manifest presence of God. Now, I know, and I'm not discounting the fact that, again, as I've said, as believers, when we accept Christ, when we commit our lives to him, he automatically, through his Holy Spirit, indwells us. So the Holy Spirit is with us. You've heard me say before, I've got a good friend that one time he went to a church and he said they spent the first 15 minutes saying, Holy Spirit, come, Holy. And he said, I just wanted to tell him, hey, I don't know about y'all, but when I came in, he's here. Because he is in us. He indwells us. But folks, we need more than just the indwelling Holy Spirit of God. We need to be in the manifest presence of God. And we need to linger there. I like the name of that conference. We need to linger there. Stay there. It's God's invitation saying, come linger. Come linger. Come have this intimate relationship with God. Jesus dealt with that in the New Testament. John chapter 15, if you've taken Master Life, you have probably memorized this. John 15, verses 4 and 5, he says, remain in me. That's that picture of intimacy. And I in you, intimacy. Just as a branch is unable to produce fruit by itself unless it remains on the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him produces much fruit because you can do nothing without me. Listen, we need to understand that. We need to understand that the invitation of God is an invitation to remain in him. We do an awful lot of stuff as Christians that we're wondering, why is it not working? Why does there seem to be nothing happening? And could it be this is the problem? We're not remaining in him? Now, by that, I don't mean we lose our salvation, but I mean we're not staying in that intimate relationship with him day in and day out. So that it is him. The success is him flowing through us. The power is him flowing through us. We're trying to bear fruit disconnected from the only way we can bear fruit, and that is to be connected to Christ. With an invitation like that, why would any of us not respond quickly? I mean, think about it. The God of the universe, the God we say that we believe in, the God that we say we believe is all-powerful, The God that we call the Almighty, the God that the Scripture teaches us about, invites us to have an intimate relationship with Him. Why would we not respond? Why do we hold Him at arm's length? I think He's calling us today to quickly respond to Him, to quickly move toward that position with Him. He is calling us to a life of intimacy with God. Now, as I looked at Moses' reaction, at first I was kind of caught off guard and I was a little surprised, and then I started thinking, you know, Moses is so much like we are, it's unreal. I want us to take a few minutes to look at his actions, because the actions of Moses tells us something about the priorities of Moses. And by the way, your actions tell us something about your priorities. And my actions tell you something about my priorities. You might think, well, an invitation like that, I mean, God saying, come up to the Lord. He calls him by name, Moses, come up to the Lord. You might say, man, he, with an invitation like that, he would surely just rush up into the presence of God. Well, let's look and see what he did. Exodus chapter 24, verse 3. Moses came and told the people all the commands of the Lord and all the ordinances. And then the people responded with a single voice, we will do everything that the Lord has commanded. See what he did? Moses preached. Now, there's nothing wrong with preaching. I mean, it's important. Preaching well is important, and I think he preached a great sermon here because the people agreed. They said, hey, we'll do everything God says. So he preached and preached well. There's only one problem. It's not what God told him to do. God said, come up to the Lord. And Moses preached. Nothing wrong with preaching, but he wasn't obedient to what God said. Look what else he did, verse 4. And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord, and he rose up early the next morning and set up an altar and 12 pillars for the 12 tribes of Israel at the base of the mountain. He journaled. Not a bad thing at all. Journaling is great. When God talks, this, when you're reading His Word and you have your journal and you're making those notes of what God said to you, you're personalizing those words. That is wonderful. I encourage it. He set up an altar. There's nothing wrong with building an altar. As a matter of fact, if you look, God tells people to build altars all the time. Only one problem. God said, go up to the Lord. He didn't say build an altar. He didn't say journal. He said, come up to the Lord. So now he's done two or three things, however you want to count it. Look at verses 5 and 6. Then he sent out young Israelite men, and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed bulls as fellowship offerings to the Lord. Moses took half the blood and set it in the basins, and the other half he sprinkled on the altar. So he made sacrifices. God has prescribed sacrifices in the Old Testament. So it was not something that God had told him not to do. So he is well within his rights and well within his area of service to offer these sacrifices. But there's a problem. God told him, come up to the Lord. Look at verse 7. He then took the covenant scroll and read it aloud to the people. And they responded, we will do and obey everything that the Lord has commanded. He read the word of God to the people. That is wonderful. We ought to read the word of God to each other. There's nothing wrong with doing that. But God told him to do what? Oh, come on. You've heard it enough. Come up to the Lord. God didn't say read the words of the people. He said come up to the Lord. Verse 8. Moses took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and said, "This is the blood of the covenant of the Lord that has made with you concerning all these words." I scratched my head for a while to figure out how to explain this one. God, Moses applied the word to the people. He applied the message of God to the people of God. Folks, application is important. Now, I'm not going to come up here this morning and splatter blood on you, but listen, it takes, whether you're a Sunday school teacher, a discipleship leader, or a preacher, there is a need to apply the word of God to the lives of the people. How does this fit in my life today? How does this, that's why preaching can't be. I can't preach somebody else's sermon because I'm not preaching to somebody else's congregation. I have to preach to you because that's what God has told me to do. And so the application, somebody else's sermon won't fit because the application won't fit. The principles are still the same, but the application is different. So we have to apply the word of God to the people. And so Moses did that, and that's important and it's needed. But there's a problem. God told him, come up to the Lord. We have read from verses 1 and 2, God gave instruction. Verses 3 through 8, Moses did everything except for what God told him to do. The invitation was come up to the Lord, have intimacy with Almighty God, and Moses immediately did about six other things. And they were good things. They were things that are prescribed in Scripture. They were spiritual things. But in so doing, he delayed doing what God told him to do. He delayed responding directly to the invitation of God. We won't take time to turn there and look at it. Folks, let me remind you, this is kind of Moses' MO, method of operation. If you took time to look back in chapter 3 and 4, you'd find him doing the same thing. He's trying to do something for God instead of being with God. But then it hit me, that's our MO too. We're doing people. I mean, how? Ask somebody, how is your time with God? How is that going? And the answer you will normally get is, I'm doing this, and I'm doing this, and I'm doing this, and I'm doing this. Stuff. Doing things. And I'm not saying doing things. Listen, doing things are important. I got up this morning and was a little overwhelmed when I looked at my schedule for today and realized it started early this morning. And with everything I've got going on that are important things and things that need to be done today, I'm going to basically, other than taking a few minutes for lunch, I'm going to basically be here till 8 o'clock tonight. Okay? I'm not complaining. I want to be doing, I do better when there's a lot of things to do, and most of us do. But listen, that is not the most important thing. And when somebody asks you about your relationship with God, please don't give a list of things. The big question is, how much time are you spending with God? What about your intimate time with God? And that can be in corporate nature, it can be in private nature. But there is a call of God to come up to the Lord, and you cannot and should not substitute things for that intimate relationship. Think about our logo, church logo. Pointing people to Christ, true north. And we use the points of the compass. The north is pointing to Christ, so that the idea is that everything we do will point people to Christ. So we do it through witnessing. That's the W. We do it through education, the E, the eastern point. And then we do it through service. So witnessing, education, and service, that kind of encompasses all this stuff that we do and we call church. And all that is important, pointing people to Christ. But listen, if that's what we're doing and we're not first and foremost spending intimate time with God, then we're missing the point. And the consistency of doing these things won't be there. The effectiveness of doing them won't be there, because the first response we have is to intimacy with God. And that means time in God's Word. That means time in prayer. That means, listen, have you ever had somebody say, well, I just don't know what the will of God is in this? Well, how much time are you spending with God? If you want to know the will of God, you have to spend time with God in that intimate relationship with God so you'll know the will of God. It doesn't come just because you show up to church. It doesn't come just because you're on a committee. It doesn't come just because you're preaching or singing or doing anything else. It comes from that intimate time with Him. I wonder, and this is a question for me too, how much time do we really spend in intimate relationship with God Himself compared to the amount of time that we do the things for God? We do church. And again, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with doing those things. We've got to be doing those things, but we've got to get our priorities right. We've got to make the first thing the first thing. The first thing, the most important thing, is the first thing. That brings us to what I've entitled, Practice Makes Perfect. If you do it over and over and over again, you spend that intimate time with Christ. Look at Exodus 24, verses 9 through 11. Moses has done all these things, and then in verse 9, it says, and Moses went up with Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 90 of Israel's elders, and they saw the God of Israel. Wait a minute. I didn't think anybody could see God. Look what happened. They went up, and they saw the God of Israel. Beneath his feet, this is God's feet, was something like pavement made of sapphire stone, as clear as the sky itself. God did not harm the Israelite nobles, and they saw him, and they ate and they drank. Wow. I mean, what else can you say? You get to go into the presence of God and see God. You look up through the pavement, and it's clear, and you see the feet of God. Now, your feet don't impress me. But let me tell you something. Can you imagine seeing the feet of God? That's what it says. Who would have thought? I wonder if Moses and those that were with him, those 74, 75 people that were with him, I wonder if they had realized if we'd have just gone on up the mountain, we'd get to see the feet of God, if they wouldn't have just moved on up quicker. I wonder if Moses would have stopped to do all the stuff, if he had any idea what was waiting on him when he got up there. And folks, he's not even to the top of the mountain yet. He's just moving in the right direction, and they get to see the feet of God. But here's what struck me. When Moses delayed because he was doing the good things instead of the one thing God told him to do, do you see how many people it affected? Over 70 people were going to get to see the feet of God, but they didn't get to see the feet of God as early as God wanted them to, because Moses delayed going up. I wonder what that says about you and I. If we don't make the first things the first things, I wonder how many other people are affected by that. I can tell you of a few, and they're inside your own home. I can tell you of some more, and they're in this church. The people that we're around are affected by our not putting things in the right order. The people that we say we love the most are affected by us not putting things in the right order. last night. We had a neat time over in the First Family Center and had a daddy-daughter dance, and I got just a few minutes to talk to some dads, and just that few minutes, what struck me is I was thinking about, okay, you've got all these people here, and they're thinking about their daughters, and what do you say to these men? And as I thought about that and prayed about that, I used a scripture that Josh referenced this morning, but then it hit me. How do you demonstrate love to your daughters? You demonstrate love, first of all, to your daughters by demonstrating your love for God. And if we as fathers and mothers don't demonstrate that love for God, then why would we even wonder why our kids don't have a whole lot to do with God? If we just do God on Sunday, or if we just do God every few times, once or twice a month or whatever, and then we wonder when they get older, they don't have anything to do with God, and we wonder why. Well, because we haven't done the first thing first. We haven't made time with God a priority. I said, you know, the first thing you've got to do, guys, is you've got to love the Lord your God with all your heart and demonstrate it in your life. The second thing is to love their mother, to love your wife, to love your wife like Christ. I didn't have time to expound on this, but like Christ loved the church, he died for her. And then you love your daughter unconditionally. You let her know that there's nothing that can separate her from your love. And she'll be your princess all her life. And I thought, man, here we go. We're standing across the street, and we're in a setting that I had, when Jennifer first asked me to speak, I didn't think of a whole lot about it. And then the more I thought about it, I was saying, what do I say? And then I realized I've got a captive audience here who are standing here holding the hands of their daughter, and they need to see that the most important thing is we see the feet of God. We go into his presence. We spend time with him because it affects everyone else. Something takes place. As Moses and this group of men move up and they see the feet of God, God speaks again. And this time, God kind of changes things. In verse 12, it says, the Lord said to Moses, come up to me on the mountain and stay there. Did you catch the change? The original instruction was, come up to the Lord, third person. But this time, God says, come up to me. As Moses began to move up the mountain, as Moses began to respond in obedience, look what God does. He becomes even more intimate in his speech. It's no longer third person to the Lord. It's first person, come up to me. He didn't make that statement when Moses was still hanging down there doing things. But when Moses started moving into that presence of God, into that intimate presence with God, then and only then did God change the language to become even more intimate. Isn't it neat? Isn't it neat that the closer I get to God, the more intimate he becomes with me? The more time I spend with him, the closer I come to being obedient to what he told me. As I move into obedience, he becomes even more personal. Oh, don't take that for granted. Don't overlook that. Quit holding God at arm's length. Move toward him. Move in. The closer you get to him, what I saw here, and it just fit for Valentine's Day, the closer you get to him, the sweeter it is. I can even sense the idea that God kind of changed his voice. You know how that is. I've heard this with church secretaries. They answer the phone different. Their voice changes. Can you imagine God's voice kind of changing? I think from that booming, come up to the Lord, to, hey, come up to me. Moses, come up to me. That's the invitation. Look at verses 13 through 18. So Moses arose with his assistant Joshua, went up to the mountain of God. He told the elders, wait here for us until we return to you. Aaron and Hur are here with you. Whoever has a dispute should go to them. When Moses went up to the mountain, the cloud covered it. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called to Moses from the cloud. The appearance of the Lord's glory to the Israelites was like a consuming fire on the mountaintop. Moses entered the cloud as he went up the mountain, and he remained on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. Check your memory here just a second. When God led and had Moses lead the children of Israel out of bondage, as they traveled, how did he lead them? During the day? In a cloud. There was a cloud. At night? Fire. So God's presence is represented by the cloud and the fire. And so this is God that has had his presence with them all the time. But look, now Moses goes up the mountain. He gets that invitation to go even closer to God, and he goes up through the cloud. That's the presence of God. As he ascends that cloud, and my first thought was, what's the big deal about the cloud? Let me tell you something. I don't know if you've ever, because in flatland you can't do this very well, but if you've ever been into the mountains and you've ascended above the clouds, now it's a little frightening when you go through the clouds, okay, because you can't see anything. You're hoping to stay on the road. But once you get up above those clouds, man, it's all different up there. You know what you don't see? All the stuff down here. See, it's something about getting into the presence of God, going up into the cloud, going up through the cloud, getting to the fire of God where God dwells, and it takes everything else and it puts it into perspective, and it pales it compared to being in the presence of God. Now, I'm not saying we ought to ignore what's going on in this world. I'm not saying that things aren't important, but I am saying that there's something about getting into the presence of God that changes your perspective on everything. And for me to understand the will of God and understand the heart of God, I've got to get my eyes off the stuff in this world and spend time with God. That's what Moses gets to do here. 40 days. 40 nights with the cloud blocking out all that stuff down below. You know, when you dwell in the intimate presence of God, when you dwell with Him in that intimate relationship, you start thinking different. You start hearing things differently. You start seeing things differently. You know, it's kind of like the only thing I can compare it to, it's like with Jerry and I. Now, on carpet, it doesn't work, but if there's tile here or that laminate flooring where you can really hear the clicking, I can tell you whether it's Jerry coming or somebody else. You see, I've been with her now for enough of years and enough of time that I recognize her gait. I recognize her walk. She recognizes my walk. She realizes that my right heel hits the floor harder than my left heel. She recognizes the cadence of my walk. Wait a minute, they saw God's feet? If you spend time with God, you recognize His walk. You recognize when it's Him in your presence. People say, well, I don't know whether God... Let me tell you, if you spend time with Him, you'll know He's there. And you'll know how to distinguish between God and anyone else because you'll recognize the walk. You'll recognize the voice. Trent spoke a couple of weeks ago on hearing the voice of God and listening to the voice of God. How much time do we waste trying to figure out whether God's saying it to us or something else is going on? Is it God talking, Satan talking, or my desires? Could it be the reason we spend so much time doing that is we don't spend enough of intimate time with God so that we recognize His voice right off the bat? Changes the way we see things. Josh told me the other day, he said, I didn't realize there were so many Toyota Tundras in this town until you got one. Because He knows me, and because He knows that's what I'm driving, it's not that there's any more in town than there was before, it's just He started noticing them. Think about this. The more time I spend with God, and the more time that I spend hearing from God and relating to God, the more quickly I recognize the truths of God that are all around that I failed to see before. He's there all along. He was speaking all along, but now I see and I hear, and everything is different because I've spent that time with Him. But you know what happened, right? As Moses spent all that time up there with God, the people down below got restless. We don't have time to cover that, but that's when the golden calf comes in. They're looking for something for security, to worship. Let me tell you something, Christians, people of God, in our current situation, in our world today, I'm afraid if we're not careful, we're going to think everything's okay with God. The election's over, and we have a president now that we say, hey, we won. What's his favorite color? Anybody know? Oh, he changed the decor, and I'm not saying that's a bad thing. His favorite color is gold. And listen, if we worship the idol of a president, no matter who he is, we've missed it. God tried to get our attention at 9/11, and we didn't pay attention very long. Listen, things are going to get worse because Donald Trump is not the answer. And if the church thinks Donald Trump is the answer, God is going to lower the boom on His people. God is the answer. And so just because we see some relief, we see some things going the way we think they ought to go, if we stop and we say, okay, we spent our time with God, we prayed and He answered and now we're good, we're wrong. We've got to remain in the intimate presence of God, because that's what He was trying to drive us to. We look at it and go, oh, the laws are going our way. The country is turning back the way we like it to be. It has nothing to do with that. It has to do with the will of God. And we've got to go to the presence of God. That means spending even more time in prayer. That means spending even more time in the Word of God, in the presence of God. Not less. Because if we spend less, then we haven't learned what He was trying to teach us. In Exodus chapter 33, we see after the calf, and Moses sets up a tent outside the city, and he calls it the tent of meeting. Sounds like committees, doesn't it? Well, that's not what it is. It is a place to meet with God. And it amazes me again when I read this text. Look at verses in chapter 33, verses 10 and 11, just very quickly. It says, as all the people saw the pillar of cloud remaining at the entrance to the tent, they would stand and then bow and worship each one at the door of his tent. So they'd look over and they'd say, okay, God is there and God is present, and there's a meeting going on, and they would worship there. And the Lord spoke with Moses face to face, just as a man speaks with his friend. Then Moses would return to camp, but his assistant, the young man Joshua, son of Nun, would not leave the inside of the tent. This young guy, Joshua. Moses is meeting with God. Joshua, according to what we were told here a few weeks ago, Joshua is probably not inside that tent. He's at his tent next door. He's kind of the caretaker there. But he sees very intimately what's going on. Do you think that might not have been part of the power of Joshua? Who got to lead the people on into the promised land? Joshua. He was on the mountain with Moses. He's there by that tent of meeting with Moses while Moses is in the very presence of God. Let me tell you something. There's no telling what God can do with our children and our grandchildren if they see us in the presence of God. No imagination of how big it could be with what God does with them. Moses was there with God and Joshua was right there. Intimacy was so special to Moses that nothing would replace it. In verses 1 through 3, in verse chapter 33, the Lord spoke to Moses, "Go, leave here, you and the people you brought up from the land of Egypt, to the land I promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give it to your offspring. I will send an angel ahead of you and will drive out the Canaanites, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Hivites and the Jebusites. Go up to a land flowing with milk and honey, but I will not go with you because you are a stiff-necked people. Otherwise, I might destroy you on the way." We get so hung up on angels, man. Listen, do you see what God just told Moses? I'm going to give you everything I promised. I'm going to send you into the promised land where it's milk and honey, it's an easy life. And not only am I going to do that, I'm going to let an angel of mine go before you. You're not going to fight a battle. He's going to wipe everybody else. So all you got to do is walk and then take it. But I'm not going. Now, some of us would take a pause and go, this isn't a bad deal. He's going to send an angel in front of me, and he's going to fight all the battles, so all I got to do is possess the stuff he's promised. I don't see Moses even thinking twice here. Moses looks at him, and he goes, if your presence doesn't go, don't make us go from here. Moses had gotten so changed by being in the presence of God, he wasn't even willing to follow an angel of God to a promise of God unless God himself went. What does that say about us? How many things do we do that we're just fooling ourselves in the fact that God's with us? I'm talking about the manifest presence of God is with us. Are we settling for something less than the best? Are we settling for his angels and not waiting for his presence? Moses loved that time with God, that intimate time, and it had such a powerful effect on his life. He said, teach me your ways. Lord, teach me. I want to know everything you've got to fill me with. Lord, I want to know it all. He said, let me see your glory. And we know that God didn't allow him to see his face because he couldn't and he wouldn't. It would have killed him, but he did let him see just a glimpse of his back. So Moses has seen the feet of God, and now Moses gets to see the back of God. Being in the presence of God has left his face glowing so that the people couldn't even stand to look at Moses. He had to veil his face. And we settle for less. What God is telling us that, church, I want to transform you as individuals. I want to transform your life as a church. But to do it, you've got to be in my presence. I want you to do things, but quit thinking things are the same thing as being in the presence of God. God has given us a great invitation to intimacy with Him. And that needs to be a priority in our lives. So I ask you, are you practicing the presence of God? Have you come to that place in your life that you would say, Lord, I don't care who you send with me. If you don't go, I'm not going. The first step to intimacy with God is a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And that means if you're here today and you've never asked Him to forgive you of your sin and to come to your life and to make you His own and for you to commit your life to being His, then that's the first step you need to do. In just a second, we're going to have an invitation, and Josh and I will be standing here at the front as we sing. We would love to share with you how you could begin that intimate relationship with God. It is not religion. It is an intimate relationship with the God Almighty. Once you do that, you need to be obedient. You need to be obedient to believer's baptism. You need to be obedient to a lot of other things. And that's part of that relationship, that living it out. But I'm afraid some of us on this other side where we've already accepted Christ and we've already committed to the church and we've become a part of the church, but we're doing the things of God and we've been satisfied with that and not saying, Lord, I'm not going to do any of it without your presence. If you don't go, I'm not going. And I'm afraid there's a lot of us here that have been doing a lot of good work trying to maintain our salvation. We knew we couldn't get it by working for our salvation, but it looks like we're trying to maintain it by doing things. It's the same faith that got us in the relationship that will hold us there. And we need to come and say, God, forgive me. Not that I'm going to quit doing things, but Lord, the most important thing is being in your presence. Or if you don't go, I don't want to go.